Hi, everybody, and welcome to episode 34 of the I Rock Knits podcast. This week's episode will include a shawl and a sweater of the week, as well as an answer to someone's question and a couple of new audiobooks. So let's get started, shall we? So welcome to Santa's house. I'm not kidding. I have a Santa collection, and it is currently out all over the house. So I'm looking at Santa's over there, and Santa's over there, and there, and there, and in there, and a wreath on the wall, and two Christmas trees, one that I bought for my daughter years ago after Christmas. I bought her a 6-foot artificial tree so that she could put all of her decorations on every year, and every year I still put that tree up because I miss her, and I would like to have all those ornaments have memories for me. So I took a picture of it the other day, and I said, your tree is up. It reminds me of all the things that we collected through the years. So there are some Barbie ornaments from when she was little, really little, and horse ornaments on it, and some really pretty ornaments. She was into Vera Bradley for a while. She liked a Vera Bradley backpack, so she has a couple of Vera Bradley ornaments on there. And I remember all those stages of her life, as do many of you I know who have children or grandchildren or Christmas memories of, you know, past and opening presents and things like that. So, however, in the spirit of full disclosure, I do not decorate my house. I have a friend come and do it, and I pay her to do that. So, I have on my Feliz Navidad Christmas sweater today that is not knit by me and polyester, acrylic, I'm sure. But I just wanted to kind of get into the spirit, and we went and got our tree the Saturday after Thanksgiving, and it was sleeting and kind of snowing and really icky out, and I don't know why we didn't go the day before when it was beautiful and sunny and nice, but we went on that Saturday, and then Carrie and her sister, my friends, come to decorate my house. So here's a little Cori stories for you today. I was complaining about the fact that I have 100 Santas in the basement all wrapped up after Christmas every year. And I said to my family, I don't want to get the Santas out. I'm not going to put them out this year. We're just going to, you know, I was very busy. It was probably 5 or 6 years ago. I don't remember if Kylie was in high school or college. She was busy and I was complaining, as I am wont to do. And I just said, oh, I just don't want to get that all out. They never want to help. I'm not that person. Like, I don't enjoy putting on Christmas music and making some hot chocolate or cider or whatever. I just want the stuff out. I'm much more a product. I want it to look nice when it's done. And so I said, I'm just not going to do it. And they both, husband and daughter, gave me this. Oh, it's always so nice when it's all out. So I was complaining, and this friend said to me, I'll put out your Christmas decorations. And I said, are you serious? And she says, oh yeah, I love to do that. So she had cleaned my house for a while when she was between jobs, and she happened to be here, and she is a floral designer by trade. She has some floral background of some kind, but she hadn't been working in that field, and they do a lovely job. Like, they're two people that stand back and say, no, I think we need a little more height in the middle, right? Like that. Whereas I'm like, Santa, 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 get them out. There's so much work to taking stuff off shelves and then putting stuff onto shelves. So I told her she could take the yarn out of this cabinet and kind of put whatever she wanted in there that I podcast in front of this. And look at, this is a little ball of yarn with pom-poms on it, and she stuck it in there to look like little snowballs. I just think it's so, so cute. And there's a little Noel sign. That little Santa sign actually lights up and flashes, but I thought it might be a little awkward if it was flashing at people, so I didn't turn it on yet. Maybe I'll turn it on before I'm done. But anyway, they came last Tuesday, and they brought a husband along to use the ladder, because I have a high window in the family room, and they put garland and lights up there. So I leave for the day, And we haul all the boxes up, and then they haul stuff back down in those boxes that they have emptied. And I'll take you guys for just a quick tour of what the house looks like. But every year for Christmas, I say to my husband, my gift this year is just to have Cori come and decorate the house. She does my window boxes out front with my two pots, which is something I had never done before then, because it's just not in my DNA to futz with greenery and, you know, red sticks, as I would call them. And, you know, some berries and things. They're very pretty. And then they have a little snow on them now. And we do a lot of entertaining. We entertain for my husband. I have told you guys this last year. I have a couple of knitting groups that come. I also have a little get-together with some dog park friends. So there are people in and out of the house quite a bit. I'm very spoiled. I feel very fortunate that all the Santas are out this year. I don't ever need someone to give me another Santa, but I sure love looking at all of them. I have a number of knitting Santas that people have given me through the years, and I think it's one of those things where people say, oh, it's a Santa. I should grab that for Cori. And so the collection has just grown and grown and grown. I have little ones. I have big, huge ones. I have glass ones and wood ones. It's just crazy for Santas around here this time of year. But I didn't do any of the work. And I find that it really makes me interested then in entertaining, because I can have people over and I'm really excited about it because I'm not exhausted from hauling decorations for like 3 to 5 days, which is what it would have taken me to do it all on my own. So, happy Advent to all of you who are getting Advent calendars in the mail or have bought Advent calendars or are getting Advent calendars. I did not get one this year. I have not knit with the yarn from the last 3 years. And so I decided no Advent calendars for me this year of yarn or other. Oh, a chocolate Advent calendar would be nice though, wouldn't it? Something with little different flavors of chocolates or something. I might have to look into that, even though, well, we're 8 days in, right? I could just eat the first 8. Anyway, okay, so there you go. So we're going to go jump right in to a shawl and a sweater of the week this week and get those done at the beginning of the podcast. So this week's shawl of the week is actually a poncho, pontini, shoulder wrap, shrug, depending on what you want to call it. But the designer called it a cowl. It is the harmonias-rings-cowl, and it's by Sivia Harding. And Sivia designed this in December of 2008, and it is a Mobius construction. And I took a class in how to do a Mobius cast on, which is actually making a figure eight with your knitting needles and then folding them over one another so that you're going around one part of the top of the circle and then around the other part. So you're constantly moving like this, but you have an actual twist in your knitting. It isn't the same as doing a twist in your cast on, I don't think. It's been explained to me a couple of times what the difference is. It's and I don't know that it's exactly the same as an infinity, but maybe. Anyway, I'm not a math person. I love this construction. I love wearing this cowl. It has beads along the cast off edge, and so I put giant turquoise beads on mine. All you have to do is be careful that you can get a small enough crochet hook through the hole to pull yarn through in order to put giant beads on like that. You just need a big enough hole to get that bulkier weight yarn through. So let me see, what else do you need to know about this? It has a chart, it's in the round, it's a Mobius, it has texture, it's a written pattern, and it was available in the original Knit Companion format. So if you use Knit Companion on your phone or your iPad or your computer, then it would have a format for that, I believe, still. It uses Cat Bordy's Mobius cast-on to achieve its mysterious spiral shape. It's worked from the center out in a self-pleating stitch pattern that adds to the warmth and coziness of this graceful garment. The cowl can be stretched over most of the head for extra warmth and protection against the elements. And I'll show you a picture of a little girl here who has it pulled up over her head. You can see how that one would also kind of get pulled up. Mine is a little stretched out. I wear it quite a bit, and I like to pull it down a little bit further. So I don't have quite as tight a neck on mine, but it was originally a little bit tighter. There is a long circular needle. So they recommend a 47 inch, but you can kind of play with that a little bit. I really enjoyed learning this cast on years ago and then using it several times thereafter. It was a bit tricky to learn it in a class because people are always chattering when they don't understand something, and this has a bit of a learning curve at the beginning, and so there were a number of restarts, I think, for people. If I kind of remember that it was a little frustrating at the beginning, you might be better served to just go to YouTube and put yourself in a quiet space and just get it cast on, and it would probably go a little bit faster. Let me know if any of you have done a Mobius construction before. I really enjoyed it. The yarn I used was speckled yarn, a black and white I think it was a cascade yarn. It's got a bit of a halo to it, and it's knit up at 16 stitches to 4 inches, but knit on a larger needle. So even though you're using worsted weight or heavy worsted weight yarn, you're knitting at a little bit bigger gauge, I think like an 8 or a 9 needle. So it's a really fun construction. I will take a couple pictures and put them in here so that you can see those beads up close. The sweater of the week this week is Miss Bibi by Bon Marie Burns. And this is a sweater that has some of its history with Stephanie Pearl McPhee, the yarn harlot, and her blog. This is the sweater that Stephanie knit for Rhinebeck a number of years ago, and it was not dry from blocking, and so she put it in the oven with the oven door open and singed the sweater. If you have followed the Yarn Harlot blog for years and years, you might remember that story, and it made, I think, everyone just kind of, you know, you do all that knitting and then you singe your sweater a little bit. But she's always a humorist and tells a great story. So if you've never followed her, she's the Yarn Harlot .ca because she's in Canada. And it's a great blog to go out and follow. But anyway, I decided to knit this. And when I do my sweater class, I often talk about this as being a very dressy sweater. It's almost jacket-like in its construction and would work really well with like a pencil skirt and kind of a buttoned-up blouse or a little camisole underneath it. It really does have some a little bit more figure fitting in it. It kind of draws in. It's got a little bit of negative ease in that sense, and then it's got the really nice shawl collar, and I'll show you that as well. So this is knit in an Aran weight yarn. It is a bottom up. It has buttons, buttonholes. It's front fastening, long sleeved, seamed. It has a set in sleeve. It has shirt rows. It is considered single breasted. It is worked flat because it's a cardigan, of course, and the notes say that you can wear this cabled lovely for a walk in the park or a stroll in the office, so it can go kind of both ways. It's a shaped jacket made in pieces and seamed with textural interest, low bulk cabling, and a trimmed shawl collar for a sophisticated look. And it's just a really pretty sweater with some really nice textured stitches throughout the whole thing. And I don't know if you'll see that as well. I've got a little shadow on the sweater here, so I'll try to turn it. So we have cables here, and then we have some pearl row that happens here for interest. And then this is a kind of garter stitch button band that goes up into this garter stitch shawl collar. One of the most beautiful things about this sweater is that the shawl collar has an actual cable stitch that runs up and over and then coordinates perfectly with this back seam coming down. It's just a stunning touch to the back of a sweater. So if you have long hair, you need to wear your hair up that day and show this off a little bit, because that's just really a nice feature. I will say that when I was knitting this sweater, there are cables on the front and the back side and over the top of the arm. I can show that maybe this way a little bit here. So you've got a cable stitch running up here, and in between you have these purl rows. So as I was knitting this, you've got a little textured stitch on this peplum bottom, and I was knitting the sleeves and I forgot to do that purl bump in between. So I had all stuck in it and I ran my cables up and I got up to over the elbows, and I knit everything in tandem. So I don't knit them two at a time, but I knit them on two separate needles going back and forth. So I'll knit 2 inches on one and 2 inches on the other, just so that things match up for me. And I was doing it on double pointed needles, and I got up to here and was so disappointed that I had not included those purl ridges, and they're integral. I mean, you couldn't leave them out. So I ripped them back. You know how you kind of decide you're just going to set something aside for a minute because you're frustrated with yourself, but you're actually mad at the project, briefly mad at the project. So I put it aside, got it back out, several days later, and re-knit the sleeves up to the same, up to the same spot. And I did the same thing again. The muscle memory kicked in and I knew what I needed to do. And I don't even think I looked at the pattern much. I just re-knit them the same way without the purl bump in them. I mean, so this is sleeve 5 and 6 of this sweater. I didn't get them completely knit, but quite a ways before I realized that that purl row comes about every 10 rows apart. So frustrated. So I had a big, issue with this sweater and getting it off the needles because I was just mad about it. I was mad at myself and mad at the sweater, and it was a lovely yarn. It's a discontinued yarn. It's on my project page if you're interested in going out and taking a look and seeing what that is. But yeah, I was really frustrated. It's a really nice fitting sweater. I'll take some close-up pictures and put them in here for you. But if you're looking for a really nice fitted jacket with kind of set in sleeves, or you've never done that construction before, it's a really nice thing to learn to actually seam, a sweater sleeve in and get that really nice shoulder fit up over the arm. And I put the square buttons down the front here. So I have 4 buttons, and I have this button band sewn shut from here to there, so that it keeps that just really nice and lined up, kind of, buttoned up and tight, with having that sewn with just a piece of thread in the background. Like, if I reach in here, I will find a piece of yarn that can be pulled out should I ever want to wear it open, although I never thought that I would. So there you go, the shawl and the sweaters of the day today. If you're at all interested in other details, you can go out to my Ravelry page, iRockKnits, and check my notes and things that I mentioned about either of these projects. I had a question from someone who watches the podcast this week, and so I'm going to answer that. I've done a little bit of talking on this before, but I'm going to answer it again. My question is simply this, and this comes from Laura Hickman. So hi, Laura. What causes pilling? Since you've knitted so many sweaters, How do you avoid having your sweaters pill? Is it a brand or type of wool? I've made several sweaters and all of them have been pilled to one degree or another. What's a knitter to do? I don't own a gleaner, but thinking of purchasing one. Well, that's your best bet to start with a gleaner, but you don't have to purchase a gleaner. You can use an emery board to take pills off of things. You can trim pills with a scissors or just a razor blade like that you would shave your legs or your underarms with. So you don't have to invest in a gleaner, although I do like a gleaner because it has three different heads. So I brought mine back here today and these just snap off the end. Like that. So I have one on there. And then there are two, they come in a little bag like this. This is more of a sandstone edge. And then I also have a travel gleaner that is more compact. And if I were gonna do it again, I might just get the travel one because I don't think you really need the big one. But this one has the blades that snap onto the inside. And then you just use it like this. Along that edge. So that's great, right? You can get the pills off, Laura, the ones that are already on there. However, when you take pills off a sweater, you're actually taking away some of the sweater. That's some of the fiber from the sweater. So the more you glean or de-pill something, the thinner those areas can have a tendency to get. And so I looked up some articles for everyone, and I will link these all in the show notes, which are underneath the podcast on YouTube, or you can go to the Ravelry group and look at the show notes for this week's project, or you can go to my website. So you can find them lots of places, but I found several articles that gave me lots of information on pilling. 5 tips to prevent clothes from pilling. There's all those pills in that picture. How to stop yarn pilling, the root causes of pilling, choosing yarns that won't pill, which I think is an excellent article. So that's the one I'm going to kind of go from here today to give you some highlighted tips. Pilling is caused by friction against your knitwear. Once the yarns pill and that felt bond is created, it's best to remove them. And there are 3 main characteristics to consider when avoiding pills. The yarn construction is first, and I have a sample here for that. This is often the most important aspect to consider when choosing yarn that won't pill. The softer the twist of the fibers, the more likely the yarn is to pill. Look at the ply or strands of fiber within the single piece of yarn. Place the yarn between your thumb and middle finger as if to snap it, and slowly twist the yarn in both directions to see how easily it is to pull the strands of fiber apart. Oftentimes, the easier it is to pull the fibers apart, the easier it is to pill. So I got some giant yarn out here to give you an example. This is a single ply yarn, and it is quite thick, but there is no twist in that yarn at all. It's just quite flat as far as all the fibers running together. This is a similar yarn, but you can see that it has a little bit of twist in it. The more twist that I would put into this piece of yarn, the skinnier it would become, and the less surface area there would be for all those fibers. So when you have long strands of fiber, the twist tends to lock those in place and you won't get as much pilling. But a single ply yarn like this is going to pill like the dickens anywhere that has friction. So don't knit a sweater with single ply yarn unless you're okay with gleaning it all the time. Then you can certainly go ahead and knit with that. Don't knit a sweater with lightly plied yarn, and unless it's twisted tightly, it's still going to pill some. And if you have sweaters that have all already pilled, Laura, my guess is you've knit them mostly with superwash merino. And that has a tendency to pill. Cashmere has a tendency, if it's got some cashmere in it. Here are yarn constructions that are less likely to pill. Chainette, high twist 2-ply, multi-ply, and felted yarn. Staple length makes a huge difference. There are some fibers that are less prone to pilling, and that is linen, silk, coarser wools, mohair, alpaca, and nylon. So I will link all these articles. Many of you already understand why your sweaters pill, because you've had the problem and then you've maybe researched it a little bit. But Laura, I hope that that helps you know that you can pick woolly wools. And if you choose woolly wools that have a twist in them, that are closer to the sheep, a little more granola, a little more scratchy, I hate to use that word, you're going to have a lot less pilling. And so there are lots of yarns out there that just won't pill at all. They'll wear really well over time, and that's not what we always choose when we go into a yarn store, right? Because our first inclination is to go over and say, oh, feel how soft this is, and buy for softness. And softness is more than likely going to get you pilling. So there you go. There's your question for the day. I had someone the other day ask me about my phone, and I said, yep, it is. And they said, I can't believe you did that to your phone. And I said, my phone is always with me. So this is what I've done to my phone. I don't love this phone case, but I got a new phone, and there you go. Can you see it? I put little black dots and made my own tape measure on the back of my phone. So now I know that my phone is 6 inches long, and I know that I can just count a half inch and an inch, a half inch and an inch all the way up my phone. So you could do it right along the edge if you've got a case on your phone. You could do it along the bottom. It doesn't have to show as much as mine does. I didn't really care. Just put it right on there. And I've used it a number of times when I've had to measure something for length. So I thought, yep, I'm going to just wear it on the side of my phone and go with it. I mentioned briefly last time that I was participating in the gift along, and thank you just so many of you that went out and bought patterns. I will be still offering my 3-for-1 buy 3, get 1 free patterns forever. I'm not going to change that. So if you're still looking to get some patterns, you may want to take a look at that. If you put 4 in your cart, it will automatically take 1 off. No coupon code, nothing. So Matt had a bag update today. So any of you who are watching this podcast in kind of real time in the next few days after I upload it, might want to go over to Etsy and Multi Crafty Guy Makes, and his shop will have some of those great bags that are made out of shirts with the buttons down the front and the little pocket. They're just really a fun bag. He's got lots of colors and styles out there, and he will also do custom orders. So if you have a shirt that you need made into a bag, I think he will also do that for you. Hey, Cori stories number 2. Yesterday, I had put a call out to some of my friends in my knitting groups and said, does anyone want to go with me to an author talk on Saturday afternoon, as well as to Be Woolen, the new yarn shop in the Twin Cities that opened this fall? And a couple people got back to me, Mary and Mary. And so we left yesterday and went up to Be Woolen, which is in the Champlin area of the Twin Cities, straight north on 169, if you're in the Twin City area. And it's just a lovely shop. She's got a really nice selection of yarn. They completely remodeled an entire space, and they had a beginning knitting class going on, which I always think is so much fun to listen in on those beginning knitters when they're learning how to do the knit stitches for the first time, and they're frustrated, and they're challenged. And do you remember that a little bit when you were first learning the knit stitch, and when you couldn't really see where to stick the needle in, or where to bring it back out, or which way to wrap your yarn? Do you go this way or this way? Anyway, I always tell people, you're punching your neighbor. That's how you wrap it. You're punching your neighbor. I don't know why that stuck with me, but I've used it for years. We've used it for years. And then we headed over to Maple Grove, to Barnes & Noble, and heard Allen Eskens talk about his new book that he has that just came out. And it was just a lovely His new book is called Nothing More Dangerous, and after we listened to him speak for about 45 minutes, he kind of went through a little synopsis briefly of each of the books that he had written and kind of where they came from and what was the inspiration, kind of where they were based. And I had read all the previous books. And his first book that he wrote, The Life We Bury, is one of my favorite books of all time. I found it just really compelling. It takes place in Minnesota. The places that you visit in the book are local to me, and so I just really enjoyed. But the premise of the book was really fascinating. The student is a young journalism major at the University of Minnesota, and I graduated with a degree in journalism too. So there were just a lot of things that really, you know, kind of it made, there was a mystery. Yeah, so really good book for me to have. Okay, so husband's going to shovel a little bit while I do this, so I'm hoping you can't hear that, but I can, and he knows I'm recording, so whatever. Patience with your spouse at all times during the holiday season, right? So anyway, his new book, he claims, is his best book he's ever written, and he worked on it for 27 years. So this is the first book he ever wrote, and then it wasn't ready, and so he ended up writing some other books. He is a lawyer by trade. He practiced law in Mankato, the town that I went to school in, where I met my husband for 25 years. So, and he's a very handsome man, did a really nice job. Not all authors are good speakers when you go, and so I really enjoyed hearing him talk. I bought his book for my dad for Christmas because my dad is a avid reader and will read almost anything I send him, and then I'm going to listen to it on audio. But I'm going to quick show you the cover of the book. Oh, it's really blowing out. There you go. His new book is based in the Ozarks, I believe, part of the Ozarks, which is where he kind of grew up, and it's about racism. It has a African-American character who becomes friends with this young black man. I haven't read it because it just came out. He's won a number of awards. One of November's best, the best mystery in November from the Library Journal, one of the best from the Mystery Tribune. He won several book awards for The Life We Bury. So, and he follows different characters from that first book. But you don't have to have read any of the other ones. They're all standalone stories. You would know the characters if you'd read that first book, but you certainly don't have to, and I listened to it. So I would highly recommend taking a look at that. And thanks to Mary and Mary for going along with me. We went to lunch. We had Portillo's, which I had not had in the Twin Cities before, which is a restaurant from Chicago, hot dogs and beefsteaks and that kind of stuff. So, yeah, it was really a fun day. Anyway, and we got to listen to a great author speak. The other two books that I have to talk to you about today are one that I finished a while back and forgot to talk about, didn't have one to talk about last time, and then realized, oh, I was halfway through one, but so anyway, keeping track of everything. I finished the book Normal People. It was by Sally Rooney. It was a 7-hour and 34-minute audiobook, and it came out last April. And I'm just going to read you a little bit of what it is about. At school, Connell and Marianne pretend not to know each other. He's popular and well-adjusted, while she is lonely, proud, and intensely private. But when Connell comes to pick up his mother from her job at Marianne's house, a strange and indelible connection grows between the two teenagers, one they are determined to conceal. A year later, they're both studying at Trinity College in Dublin, and it goes from there. Really interesting. Don't know if it was a favorite book ever. It got mixed reviews, like people love it, and some people really don't like it. I fell on the can't get it out of my head afterwards, right? Like, didn't necessarily love it all the way through. Not a lot seemed to happen, and their relationship is not a super healthy one, and they both have issues, but normal people, right? Don't we all have things in our past or things that, you know, happen to us that cause us to act in the ways that we do? And I just keep thinking about it. So then in my mind, That's a good book because it resonates after the fact. So go out and read a little. Do some kind of pre-reading yourself to see if you think that that's something that you would actually like. It has 4 stars on Audible, and I usually read things that are a 4 and above on Audible as an average. The other book that I just finished was called The Woman in the Window. I started it on Monday after book club last week and finished it yesterday. 13 hours and 42 minutes. A friend in book club announced to the book club that she just finished this book that she could not put down. It was a thriller and it kept her thinking the whole way. And so I thought, well, I just finished this other book. I will download it and get started. And I really did find it fascinating. I thought at the beginning, you know how you do, you kind of think, oh, I kind of have this figured out. Like, I know because she said it was a thriller and I read the, you know, review and a little bit about what it was about. So I kind of know where it's going. No, I didn't really know where it was going. So Anna Fox lives alone, a recluse in her New York City home, unable to venture outside. She spends her day drinking wine, watching old movies, recalling happier times, and spying on her neighbors. Then the Russells move into the house across the way, the perfect family. But when Anna, gazing out her window one night, sees something she shouldn't, her world begins to crumble, and its shocking secrets are laid bare. So it is definitely kind of a quick-paced thriller. There is no blood and gore. I don't go in for that much. I mean, if a murder happens in a book, I like a murder mystery, but I just don't like a lot of, and this is really a little more psychological and has a lot to do with her and her agoraphobia. And I have, my mom's friend has agoraphobia and really has trouble leaving her house or going into unknown open spaces. I knew a woman in the past who also had it, and so I found that fascinating and interesting to read about, to learn a little bit more about. So The Woman in the Window, it got 4 stars as well on Audible, and it came out in January of 18. So if any of you have read Normal People or The Woman in the Window, come over to the Ravelry group or comment below and let me know if you liked them or didn't like them. I never really know how much time to spend on books. I'm a huge reader. I was an English teacher. I'm not really willing to give up the segment to just keep it all about knitting, but I don't want to go on too much. So I'll just tell you what I'm reading and tell you a little bit about what it's, whether or not you're getting a little list going of books that you'd like to read. Let's do some hellos today. Welcome to Courtney Lancaster in Arizona, who used to have a podcast that I used to watch. Edeena Cole. Oh, Edeena's going to law school. And as an adult, going back, you know, to school. And I'm so impressed with that. I just think that's awesome. She got in. She's going to start after the, new year here. Oh, it's so cool. My favorite librarian, Jane, in South Dakota, Rachel Weissenstein, Sharon of the KnitNStyle podcast. And if you haven't watched the KnitNStyle podcast or haven't ever seen any of Sharon's yarn, you should go over and take a look at that. I saw Sharon at Rhinebeck. Jennifer Page, Rita Wood. Hi, Rita. You and I have gone back a little bit back and forth this week. Michelle of Knit Takes Two. You always come and comment. Kind of makes my day. Penny, Lisa Smith, Chantal R., Sharon Deardorff, Irene, happy birthday, Irene of the 3-Ply podcast. I saw that on Instagram this week. PJ, Knitting with Quills, Sabrena Shelton, Jesse's Mom 12, Knitting Bandit 45, Prudence, Peggy Bork, Robin Gasser, Angela Jenkins. Angela lost her sweet pup. So I've been thinking about her a lot, about a month ago. Pat Wagner, Melanie Cahoon, Karen Tumblin, Melissa, Emma Butcher. Hi, Emma. I'm glad you think it's funny that I talk about you on the podcast. Liza Kingston Coleman, Melinda Zaccardi Rousseau, Helen Henry, Astrid Ermanis, who's new. Hi, Astrid. Astrid just found me. So hello. Chris Osborne, Amethyst 19, Anissa M, Lisa Gregg, Jean Zerzinski, Stephanie Heberman and Suzanne, So Run It, we comment back and forth quite a bit on Ravelry, etc. So all of you made comments on the podcast last week. I always appreciate that. I hope that I've gotten back to every single one of you. I make sure that I'm always answering questions. Matt told him on Thursday he's been working quite a bit and he's behind in answering some questions from people. But he got a really nice comment from someone, and it wasn't to me, so I won't say who that is, but she'll know who she is. And her son has started to knit because he saw Matt on the podcast. And he's a young man who didn't know that men could knit. And Matt, I just think that if nothing else comes out of this podcast ever, that's amazing, right? That there's a little boy, 12 years old, who said to his mom, I could knit like Matt. Oh, isn't that great? And could look up to Matt in that way. So I'm going to wave hello to that little boy, because I would assume that he will watch with his mom. And I want him to know that I think that that's amazing. And you can come over and comment on my podcast and tell me what you're knitting on, because Matt and I would love to know. One more tip this week, and it's not really mine to share, so I'm not really sure how I'm going to go about this, but I have a former acquaintance that lives here in the Twin Cities who is an amazing knitter and teacher, and her name is Susan Rainey. And Susan has some tutorials, she has a blog, she has a few patterns that she's published, and they're always amazing. She's a very talented, technical, fine knitter. And I was, I don't know, scrolling through something the other day on Instagram. She is a has a blog with her sister. It's called The Rainey Sisters, so you could look that up. And she had posted a comment about a video that she had made on called No End Stripes. And so I went over and watched it, and I found it fascinating. I had seen maybe the technique in my past. I know I had seen the technique. I just can't remember how long ago it was. And you actually knit stripes into something, and you don't have any ends to weave in when you're done. So it's a really interesting technique whereby you're working with how much yarn you're going to use up before you get to the end of that strand, and then swapping it out for the new strand so that when you come to turn around to do the new row, you're starting right in with the new color. It's really fascinating. You're doing some spit splicing and some checking of stitches and how wide they are. But I will put a link in the show notes for anyone who is interested in learning something new, which is what I'm always all about. I definitely do not have all the answers about knitting. I would never claim to say that I have all the answers or that I can figure anything out. I've just been knitting for a really long time, so I have some experience. I would be an experienced knitter, but not necessarily do I know all the tips and tricks that there are to know. As a matter of fact, I know Susan knows a lot of tips and tricks that I don't know. So if you would like to take a look at that, I will link it in the show notes. It's a YouTube video. You could go under Susan Rainey, R-A-I-N-E-Y, and it was called No End Stripes. And so it was very interesting. I just want to do a little bit of a heads up here today about some patterns that I have been working on that will be coming out shortly. So I'm going to be looking for a slew of test knitters if I can get my act together and finish up some things with my tech editor. And she had a computer issue and lost a bunch of computer files, and so she had a backup, but she's having to like back things up and find things, and so we've kind of gotten slowed down in our process a little bit. But so I kind of had to back off on what I had coming up in the queue for her. But I have a knitted bag based on the sweater that I knit for Rhinebeck coming out. I have a skirt, two skirt patterns coming out. I have a hat and mitten pattern getting finished up. I have two sweaters that I don't think are ready, won't probably even be ready till the spring, because I'm only partway down on both of them. But I have a kind of a list in my phone where I keep track of the things that need to happen next, and I'm going to be looking for some test knitters. So keep your eye out on Instagram for that. I will also mention on the podcast as it comes, you know, probably not right over the holiday time here will I end up doing that, but I just wanted to give those of you who have been interested in the past a heads up for that. And then I am reissuing my Nice Capades sweater. It's the sweater that has the snowflakes across the top of it in larger sizes. So I am upping the sizes. So if you are a broader shouldered, bigger busted person and you're interested in knitting that sweater, I will be providing $50 of yarn support for you to get, you know, some or all of your yarn for that sweater and then knit it for me as a test knit to kind of check the numbers and see how that all works out. And that will be happening in the next little bit here. And there is not a real strong hard deadline on that. I just need it to be done sometime in the next couple of months. So if that's something that you're interested in, maybe you should get in touch with me. I will say that immediately following the last podcast, I had several offers to do some data entry work for me. I took the first person who had an excellent resume right away, had some good computer skills, and don't know her that well, but I told her if she was willing to do it, and she's like, yeah, just tell me what to do, and they're all almost done. Within 7 days, we had to wait for the company to approve the information, but all of my patterns that are currently available on Ravelry will now be available on Love Knitting, as well as in my Etsy shop. So all of that information that was on Ravelry had to be uploaded into other areas and copied and pasted over: the needle size, the gauge, the stitch pattern, the tags, the labels, the sizing. It's a bunch of piddly work, but we've gotten almost every pattern approved on Love Knitting, and it's now called Love Crafts. I think they changed it from, if you Google Love Knitting, I think it comes up as Love Crafts, and I'll double check on that and put it in the show notes. But if you are a person that is looking to purchase yarn to go with patterns, that is Love Knitting's niche. They require the designer to tag yarns that would work well for that project. So if you want to knit let's say one of my hat patterns, and you don't know what yarn to use, you could purchase the yarn on Love Knitting with the pattern. So it's kind of a format whereby you go out, you look at the yarn, there'll be a list of yarns that you can use for it. You pick the yarns, you put them all in your cart, and you can check out. So it's a really interesting concept, and I have allowed this person who's doing all this work for me to pick all the yarns to go with all the patterns. It's just a meticulous process of going through their site and kind of picking things out and figuring out what weights would go and what would work well. And so you could take a look there, as well as my Etsy store has always been open since I had pins for sale, and I decided that it would just be nice to have all the patterns up there as well. So that is almost done. We're getting really close and should be done in the next. By the time this comes out, I think every pattern should hopefully be approved and be out there. So another job, another check thing off the list of things that needed to be done this fall when I was traveling so much and not getting a lot of other things done. So briefly, I'm going to talk about a project that I'm working on. I don't usually do that, but my current work in progress is a Bits and Bobs Fisherman's Rib blanket for my daughter. And she doesn't watch this, and it's finals week, so I know she in law school, so I know she won't see it. I don't want to knit on anything else. It's so much fun. I bought a giant cone of cream yarn, and I'm using all my fingering weight scraps held double with this giant cone of cream yarn. I don't know if you guys are like me at all, but sometimes when something has to be knit, I'll do anything but the thing that I have to do. Are you that way with household chores or other things? So I bought this giant cone of yarn, and you can purchase them. This is called Sheila's Gold, and it's from wool2dye4.com. And I bought 8020 Superwash Merino Nylon, and I think this has cost $70, something like that. It's very heavy. It's fingering weight yarn. And I was going to do a crocheted blanket holding this with all my scraps. But I'm not a great crocheter. I'm learning, but I'm not fast or good at it. And so the other day, I don't know, a week ago, I said, I'm just going to try that fisherman's rib, because I hadn't done it for a long time. And it's fisherman's rib is so easy. You get the look of brioche, but it doesn't. So this is what I've gotten done so far. And it's quite long. Like, this is going to be a full-size two-person blanket. And my daughter is a pastel, whereas I'm a bright. And so when I was going through yarn scraps, I have jars all over where there's one right here. Can you guys, I know you've probably seen it before, but let me turn this a little bit. See, there's a jar of yarn right there. I have jars of ends and yarn all over my house. and they stare at me and I think, oh, you just need to use up those beautiful yarns. So at one point I was cleaning out a giant jar that I had stuck some packages of mini skeins in, and I just kept shoving them in the top as I would collect, or in those cellophane wrappers, and it was a mess. So one day I was walking by it and I thought, I just need to dump those out. So I did, and as I was sorting through that whole jar of yarn, I put aside all the peaches and the creams and the pale blues and the light greens, pretty much as just in a thought of making that crocheted blanket up into something for Kylie, because she's got her first apartment now, and you know, so. And then I started this Fisherman's, which is knit one in the row below. Knit one in the row below. You can watch a video on it. Kay has a video on, Kay Jones of the Bakery Bears podcast has a video on the pattern, and that's how it is turning out. So you just get these long lines. It is almost as hard to fix as brioche. If you make a mistake and you know, if you get off your count going across, it's hard to drop it down if you're several rows up before you notice it and fix it. I watched two Bristol Ivy videos, one on fixing brioche and one on fixing fisherman's rib. Again, learning, trying to figure out the difference and see what the difference was and how you would pick things up. And I was able to ladder down and pick back up a strand that had fallen off the front or the back of the, not that I thought that it would show, but I wanted to kind of prove to myself that I could do it. And all you have to remember is that you dip into the knit row, you dip in the row below is the knit row. So it really is not too onerous. I will definitely be making, holding all of my fingering weight scraps double, holding my worsted weight scraps. I have so many scraps and I just think it's just turning out. It's mindless. I don't really have to think about it. I can sit down in the evening when I'm done with my computer work, and I should be knitting on Christmas gifts. You guys, I have two or three more Bada Bing Pontinis to make. I have a sweater, hat, or scarf for my nephew, my young nephew, because I always make for them. I finished the leg warmers for my niece, my little niece. They turned out darling. I have a picture of those on Instagram. And I'm making a small size, child size Bada Bing Pontini for my 11-year-old niece. So I had to kind of downsize it a little bit for her. And that's about halfway done. That's what I was using some of the Knit Picks yarn for, and the colorways that she liked. I think I talked about that a little bit. And I have some, a pair of socks to finish. I had some tubes cranked, and so, and they've been sitting in my, so all I have to do is put the, I have the top on, and all I have to put is the heels and the toe, and I could gift a friend shawl for my mom for Christmas in blues, in the ZK 2019 Suburban Stitcher blue mini skein pack that we got, and that needs to get finished up and be blocked, or be put out with some other things that need to be blocked. And what am I working on? Something that won't be done by Christmas. Absolutely not. It shouldn't be, because that would mean I'm knitting all day, every day, just on this. But Kylie has a birthday in January, so this would be a perfect gift for her birthday. But I'm really enjoying it. And that white, that cream in with every color kind of tones everything down. But if you had scraps of cream or gray or beige in your stash, you could certainly stripe each color with another color that would tone it down and kind of get everything to kind of match. So if you had, you know, say a bright blue and then you had a light gray skein, you could hold those two together, and then the next section you could hold a cream with a bright yellow, and it would kind of give this kind of muted effect still. I think you would not have to buy one of these from Wool to Die For, one of these giant skeins. This was also in my stash closet, and I was saying, you bought that and there it sits. So I really am enjoying that quite a bit. I went to the bag closet the other night, December 1st, right after Thanksgiving and got out my Christmas bags and laid them on the chair. And it's a week later and they're still laying on the chair because I didn't transfer anything in. But they make me so happy. So to close today, I'm going to show you some of the cute Christmas bags I have. I have the Grinch. This is from Silver Shed USA. She's got a great website with tons of Christmas bags. I like this style that has the handle because I can take my knitting and then use this for a purse and put my wallet in it and my phone and go and be off and running. So I love that. This one is absolutely darling. And this was made by a friend years ago for, but it has sparkle for a gift. This one was, this is one of my favorite bags. I would carry this. I carry this all winter because it's snowman, right? And this is by Silver Shed USA. I just think it's so darling. It's the snowman with the big carrot nose. Two little buttons for eyes. And this is my dog, holiday dog bag. And this is from my friend Renee, who made bags for a while, but now is working full time and doesn't have a shop anymore. But she was Brown Dog Bags. And she, her dog and my dog played together. But Christmas bags make me happy. This time of year, to put your knitting in a Christmas bag. I mean, I feel really fortunate that I have four or five just Christmas bags, and I start using them usually in mid to late November and use them all the way through the holiday. And I carry knitting everywhere, and I, you know, I go to knitting groups all the time, and I'm always teaching, so I'm always carrying knitting bags with my knitting in it, because before, after class, sometimes I have to sit and knit for a few minutes while people are coming or leaving, or I have to lock up the rooms, so I often get a few stitches knit, so I always have a cute bag, and just, they just make me smile. So I thought, well, when I've got my Feliz Navidad, I had to explain this to my husband today, that Feliz, F-E-L-I-Z, Navidad, is Christmas, Merry Christmas, you know, in Spanish. And he was like, okay, that's so weird that you have a sheep Christmas shirt. But yeah, what can I say? So, looks like we're about an hour in already, and I didn't think I had much to talk about today, so I'll try to edit this down a little bit because, of course, I ramble, and I will give you a little tour of some of the Santa decorations at the house so you can see how crazy my house is. Parties start next Saturday, then we have one Monday. Tuesday we go to someone else's party that Wednesday, and I have one Thursday. So running up to the new year, I hope you and yours have a really calm, quick middle of December here. Whether or not you celebrate Christmas in your home, it can be a crazy time of year for people and for families. So I hope that your knitting is snag-free, that you don't have any struggles with it. And in the meantime, keep it colorful, waddle on.